Welcome to Romance Studies 202, Conversations. And today I'm very happy to have Tim Beasley-Murray, who is, he is a professor at University College London. And he also happens to be my brother. So we will be talking about, Romance Studies and languages, and we may also talk about families in what follows too. So Tim, thanks for doing this. And I thought I'd start by just asking a little bit about where you're coming from. For instance, I know that you did an undergraduate degree in what was called modern medieval languages, or a faculty of modern medieval languages. And you did a couple of languages there, and now you're at UCL. I'm interested in the ways in which languages and literatures are divided up differently, often quite radically differently, in different places, and what your experience of that is, and what your thoughts of that might be.
Thanks, John, and it's a privilege to take part in this wonderful series and to have this family conversation about Romance Studies. So I did a degree in modern and medieval languages, where I guess the point was modern here and medieval sets it off from the classics. And I think, you know, that's quite important, that it's, you know, it's a relatively, as a discipline that came into being the end of the 19th century or middle of the 19th century. And it was unusual, the idea that you would look at modern languages. I guess that was the first point. And there I did, you know, Czech and Russian and German, and a little bit of French towards the end. But I think the idea was that we thought of each literature in terms of its national context, right? You know, I think that was the way that it tended to work. I was in a department in Cambridge of Slavonic studies. And there was this idea, Slavonic is a linguistic term that refers to the Slavonic family of languages. But frankly, you know, we looked at things individually. And there was no department of Romance Studies, right? There was a department of French and a department of Italian and so on. And now at UCL, similarly, I think we have a tendency to think of these languages, yes, in combination. So people at UCL will do, I don't know, French and Spanish or German and Portuguese or something. But still, each little department will be thinking of the connection of a language to some body of a nation, right? And then at the other end, what we do an awful lot of now that we didn't do at Cambridge was work comparative literature, where we think globally and we'll bring together, I don't know, students will bring together, you know, Chinese novels with American novels or French novels with something else. But I think what's interesting about Romance Studies, which you want to reinvent, I'm going to suggest, is it suggests somewhere in between. We might look at some grouping that isn't that of the language tied to the nation, and it isn't some sort of global, you know, sort of Weltliteratur, where world literature, where everything contributes to some sort of global whole, but it's some in-between grouping that is given by something else, and that's whatever Romance Studies is and what we're trying to answer here.
Right, so you have a whole series of national disciplines, which sometimes are in the same bureaucratic bucket, but don't necessarily talk to each other. Then yes, you have this idea of complete or comparative literature, which traditionally was very European-based, right? You do French, you do German, you do, I don't know, Italian or something. And then Romance Studies is this in-between thing, right? I think you're right that's what we're trying to do. Well, that's the premise here. The justification being the notion that there is some kind of pre-existing relationship between the so-called Romance languages, French, Italian, Spanish, Portuguese, but also Galician and Catalan and Romanian and I don't know, Provençal and so on and so forth, right? I wonder, is that justification enough? I mean, what does that notion of a family of languages, it's often this familial metaphor, right? This familial family of languages, does that do enough, do you think, to constitute an object of study?
I think, you know, certainly we're talking with students in this conversation here, and sometimes we spend so long as students, you know, learning a language and think I'm learning French or I'm learning Portuguese or I'm learning Italian. And it's quite useful, you know, if you land in a country of a language in a country whose language you don't speak, but you speak another member of the family, right? When I speak French and bad Italian in non-existent Spanish, but in Madrid I'll try and speak to someone in a restaurant in my broken Italian and it works. Or, you know, if I speak to a Polish person, I'll speak in Czech and we'll make ourselves understood. And reigniting that linguistic proximity and realizing that when you spend all your time learning Italian, actually that means you'd find it pretty easy to learn Romanian if you could get your head around all the weird vocabulary that's in Romanian. I think that's quite exciting as students, and that's rather old-fashioned. And a nicely old-fashioned, I'm talking pre-20th century approach to language, you know, that I remember when I started learning a Slavonic language, someone said to me, well, you don't learn Czech, you don't learn Russian, you learn, it's all one long language and you're just learning a bit of it, and you should lift up your eyes and realize that you could understand all of them. And that can be very exciting, right? And that you're a student of Italian and you could pick up something in Spanish and it doesn't bother you and so on. I think this perspective, which is a sort of historical and linguistic one that's based on the origin of these languages in Latin, that they're a degree of comprehensibility, they share a source, they've developed in different ways. I think what it allows us perhaps to today is to produce new constellations, you know, to make dialogues that otherwise wouldn't happen between, you know, literature written in French in Haiti and literature written in Portuguese from Angola or Italy or wherever it might be. And I think that those sort of unusual constellations that come from when we take this perspective is quite exciting. Now, it could be said it's completely arbitrary. We could just read, right, novels or poems written by authors whose name begins with L. Or P, or, you know, novels by writers who were left-handed or something. But just for a moment, that can be quite defamiliarizing. It can shake up these categories, the national categories, perhaps, that we're used to using, and can make us see things differently. So I think that's productive.
So there's a whole bunch of things in what you just said. So one might be the relationship between language and, let's say, culture, or language and literature as an intermediary thing. So the mere fact that these languages are related come out of a common root, for instance, to what extent might that mean that the literature written in them has any relationship? And maybe it doesn't. Maybe that's the arbitrariness, right? So that's one thing. Then I guess another question is trying to get beyond why one might want to get beyond that national focus, right, which is otherwise so common, right? Looking at, you know, national canons in which, I know, Shakespeare for English and Cervantes for Spanish and Dante for Italian, right? You've got that kind of sense of hierarchy, and shaking things up a bit might make us rethink the whole notion of hierarchy, perhaps. Is that part of what you're talking about?
So, yeah, I want to come to that in a sec. But first of all, I want to dispel one thing that some people might think, and it's certainly an old-fashioned idea, which would be this connection between language and culture, that there might be a Latin, a Romance way of thinking.
A mentality
that's given by the structure of the languages, their syntax, their morphology. There may be some, you know, this would be an old idea going back to the thinker like Herder, that somehow a German thinker in the Enlightenment and proto-romantic, but this idea that language shapes thought, language shapes culture, and that's almost given by the grammar, the fact that, with the exception of Romanian, that does things rather differently, but the word order is the same in the Romance language, that expressions are often shaped in the same way, that this might shape a mentality. Frankly, that is nonsense, right? That is nonsense for, you know, first of all, linguists, you know, the whole Sapir-Whorf hypothesis, which is a modern version of that Herderian idea, has been totally disproved. And I think, you know, I think we can move beyond that sort of very 19th century idea. So I think I think that's worth thinking about, but it's worth thinking about in order to dispel. But I think the stuff about hierarchy, I think is interesting. What's interesting about the Romance languages is that they all come eventually from Latin, right? Classical Latin from this language, which was the language of, you know, the biggest empire, right, of the pre-modern period, right? So it's the language of power, Latin. But the languages that come out of Latin and not the language that was spoken in the Senate at Rome, or the language that were, you know, Ovid or Catullus or Horace, whoever wrote their fine poetry in. It was the language of the ordinary soldier who went to occupy wherever it was, Gaul or Dacia or Iberia, and mixing with the locals who picked it up and so on. These are sort of, and I think you say it in one of your lectures, these are sort of bastard languages. These are languages of the encounter with ordinary people as the empire begins to fall apart. And the reason why they come into being as languages of prestige is precisely because the empire falls apart. That's why you can have, you know, Dante starts writing in the Tuscan dialect, and in France, the Provençal becomes a literary language, and French and so on. It's because the Roman Empire no longer exists. So they bear with them in a really interesting way, a sort of post-imperial identity, a sense of the empire coming apart, diversifying, mingling with, you know, the local cultures, producing forms of hybridity and so on. So here we're talking, right, in the sort of from what used to be called the Dark Ages up into the medieval period. But the modern existence of the Romance language is that too. Right, as different empires, the Spanish Empire and the French Empire and the Portuguese Empire, took Romance languages to the rest of the world, right, you know, in ways that are often violent, right, and extremely problematic, but still these cultures that have arisen, you know, of the Francophone world or the Lusophone world or the Hispanophone world, are ones of hybridity, encounters of different cultures where they create some new forms. That is, has nothing to do with the purity of, let's say, Castilian Spanish, and even less to do with the purity of, you know, classical Latin, right? Sort of Virgil's Latin. And I think that's why the idea of Romance studies is quite exciting, that it tells us something about what happens when power is disrupted, when things become more heterogeneous, where things produce new forms of hybridity that are still exciting and still worth comparing. And that goes for the sort of post-Roman Empire situation, but I think it also accounts for, you know, the post-colonial situation of you know, our own post-colonial situation.
So again, I want to pick up on a couple of things there. So one is, yes, the notion of the Romance mentality is nonsense. You get that. That's the whole, like, the Eskimos with 50 words for snow, which is just not true on any level. But that doesn't mean that we throw out an interest in language, right? That there's the language and language change, that kind of philological exploration that you were talking about earlier, actually does tell us things, right? It tells us something about the ways in which Latin interacted with and changed and mutated in different ways in different parts of Europe and elsewhere. So it doesn't mean throwing an interest in language out. It means looking at language in different ways. And that notion of Latin as the language of power, and even after the fall of the Roman Empire, is continued use in the church, for instance, among intellectuals, as opposed to the vernaculars, right? So we've got this distinction between the classics and the vernaculars, and that goes back to what we were saying right at the beginning, that traditionally in the 19th century, for instance, in the English university, you'd study the classics because that was worth studying, whereas even English, when it first comes to start being a university discipline in the late 19th, early 20th century, was looked down upon, right? That this was somehow, let alone French or Spanish or what else, that these were somehow not really languages fit for study in the ways that classics were. So there's a hierarchy in which now the vernacular comes to take over and increasingly supplant the classical, the language of order, unfortunately often remodeling itself, however, right, on that vision. That's kind of the tragedy of what happens to the study of modern languages and literatures in the university. They model themselves on the classics rather than turning against that classicizing view.
Yeah, Absolutely. I think there's an awful lot in what you're saying. Incidentally, my own university, UCL, which was the third university in England after Oxford and Cambridge, was, of course, the first to introduce modern languages back in the 1830s, right? Oxford and Cambridge didn't do that till the early 20th century or whatever, the end of the 19th century. But it was a sign of its modernity as this thrusting sort of new London university engaged with the real world that it did. You know, Italian and German, I think, were the first to have, maybe French or whatever, right from the beginning. But I think this is interesting, the way in which, you know, the question might be, to what extent do Romance literatures sort of bear testament to this vernacular, more popular sort of place where they come from? And to what extent are they always trying to establish themselves as a new Latin? You think of, for example, you know, towards in the medieval or early modern period, do people choose whether to write in the vernacular or in Latin according to what they're able to write about? I'm thinking here of, you know, Rabelais, his extraordinary sort of, you know, comic, grotesque sort of, you know, obscene stories that could only be in French, could perhaps, I'm going to suggest. I'm sure a Rabelais scholar would tell me different, right? And wouldn't be in Latin. But you know, I think it's an interesting idea that maybe in the desire to establish themselves as proper national languages, languages of power, Romance languages or Romance literatures lose touch with that, you know, the earthiness of the language of the Roman soldier that actually gave birth to them. I feel we need a specialist. We need a philological specialist who could explain to us better exactly how that process came about.
And so finally, let's contrast this approach in which language and implicitly literature, I think we have to justify that in some ways, comes to the center as opposed to a sort of area studies approach. So for instance, you know, Latin American studies, about which I know something, you've got, in theory at least, sociologists talking to historians, talking to literary critics, talking to economists and so on, all on the premise that, you know, there's some sort of social unity or something to in which all those different disciplines get to talk to each other on the basis of that this area of the world is somehow sociologically and politically and economically distinct and but yet integrated in some ways. But by making language the center of things, suddenly it's literature which comes to the fore. We're getting rid of the notion that there's a romance world or a romance mentality or romance Catholicism is somehow important. But we're putting the ways in which literature reveals something about the uses of language, about the politics of language, perhaps, but still a politics of language rather than a politics more generally, and how that might, yes, be an alternative to these kinds of area studies, whether it's Asian studies or Latin American studies.
I think it can be really liberating to do that. You know, like you, I spent 20 years in an area studies institution that was called the School of Slavonic and East European Studies. So part of it was Slavonic, that's the equivalent of Romance, but part of it was area, the stuff spoken in Eastern Europe. And there is absolutely this tendency to say what's in common is a set of historical experience, a set of social experiences. That's what shapes literature. It's, you know, communism, or in the case of Latin America, it'll be, I don't know, you know, authoritarianism of a different kind. And that's what will bring us together. And we tend to look at literature as some sort of testimony to something else, right? Some set of experiences that are given by things that aren't literary. And I think it is exciting to think about what happens when we once again, yeah, put language at the heart of things, and we can allow ourselves to be a bit more disciplinary. And I think we should, because we will need to end at some point, maybe talk about families, right? The Romance languages are families. They are brothers and sisters and cousins. But the thing is, they don't get together very often, right? You know, they've been dispersed to different parts of the world. One's in London and one's in Vancouver and one's somewhere, or to use the Romance family, one's in Romania and one's in, you know, Martinique and one's in Angola and one's in Spain. What happens if we we bring them together and put them in the same room, and they realize that actually they can talk to each other, and you know, they don't just talk about where they're from, but they try and see what they have in common and what differs and so on. And I know that's a metaphor, but it's actually quite a good metaphor, right? That allows one to you know, this long lost distant family, someone who's got very rich, you know, that'd be a French cousin, and someone who's, you know, history has treated them less kindly, that's someone, you know, someone from somewhere else. But let's bring them together and look at what they've got in common. And it's language. And then that means it's literature. It's the way they tell their stories. It's the way they write their poetry. It's the way they choose their words and so on. And in a world where literature, I'm afraid, or an academic world, you know, too often is seen as, right, shaped by society or history or economics, or literary studies are a handmaiden to sociology or something else. It's quite nice to do this. You know, that's why I think, you know, it's one of the many reasons I think romance studies is worth reinventing.
We should stop there, except I want to say one more thing about that familial metaphor is, there's two ways of looking at it, I suppose, right? So one is this genealogical thing where you're looking for forebears and ancestors, and that kind of reintroduces that hierarchy, right? But what we've done by excluding Latin, by it being, you know, modern and medieval, right, which is like the cutoff from Latin, it's like it's all those cousins and brothers and sisters, including the, you know, the long-lost cousins or the bastard brothers and sisters, but without, right, that genealogical impulse to try to impute authority to some kind of, you know, the father of the family, right, the pater familias. So it's like a familialism, but it's a sort of unruly familialism, which I think if we make it an unruly family, then I like the metaphor better than that notion, right, of the genealogical generational family. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, and I think we've got to be realistic. I would encourage all your students to meet the other members of the family and learn how to speak to them. But we're not necessarily all going to become classicists, right? We're not necessarily all going to be reading Virgil in Latin and so on. You know, we can say, yes, there is a historical interest in that. What I guess, by the way, quickly, what's different with the Romance family and the other families is we have the progenitor. Mm-hmm. Right. Whereas in the case of Germanic and Slavonic, we have to reconstruct what the language was that gave birth to or was originally behind it. But I agree with you. I think, you know, I think there's something more progressive. There's something more exciting about banishing the father, banishing the grandparent, and seeing what sort of unruly family in the present, you know, what sort of family gathering that unruly family in the present, you know, what conversations they can have between, as I say, a Haitian writer and an Italian writer and Angolan writer and a Romanian writer. That's that unruly family is. I want to hear those conversations.
Well, that is what we will attempt to do in this course, to have these unruly but productive conversations between these different estranged brothers and cousins and sisters and so on and so forth. So, well, thank you, Tim, so much for this. I think this has been a very interesting and productive conversation along those same lines.
Thank you, John. Thank you.